Good morning. We open our service with ringing our peace bowl, affirming our collective hopes for peace within ourselves and in our troubled world. At the same time, we pause to remember that the lands where we live are the ancestral lands of the Yavapai people, the Wekupekas, the Tolkepayas, the Kuevkapayas, and the Yavape. Greetings and welcome to our service. It's wonderful to see all of you here this morning, those of you who are here in person and those of you who are online as well. Welcome to Granite Peak Unitarian Universalist Congregation, and we're coming to you from Prescott, Arizona. I'm Bobby Bollinger. I'm your worship associate this morning. Our minister, the Reverend Patty Willis, is currently on sabbatical and will return to the pulpit in March. For the benefit of newcomers, as well as longtime congregants, we review again the mission statement of our congregation. We are a compassionate, spiritual community that celebrates diversity, nurtures the personal and spiritual growth of all ages, shares our gifts, promotes justice for all, and serves the world we live in. Following the service this morning, we encourage you in the sanctuary to stay for socializing in our coffee-less coffee hour, either here or you can go outside and enjoy some of this beautiful weather. If you're viewing us on Zoom, consider staying online, and Heather will connect you to a breakout room. This will give us time to chat with one another in small groups, something that we have all missed during this time of isolation. And to newcomers, if you would like more information about us, please check out our website at prescottuu.org. And for contributing to today's service, We thank our pianist, Lena Huben, our music director, Mary Lou Prince, our guest speaker, Anna Fleury, our Sunday morning volunteers, and this morning's superb technical crew, Heather Knowles and Elaine Hayes. Right now, for those of you who are here with us in person, if you'll please take a moment to be sure that your phones are set on worship mode. I'd like to direct you to a few announcements this morning. You'll find them in your order of service, the weekly peek, or on our website. They include information about upcoming movies, our congregational dinner, the Wednesday morning forum, faith development classes, and Friday's lunch with the board president. Bev and Robert, our children's faith development program leaders, hold in-person classes each Sunday at 10 for pre-K in the nursery, while the older children meet in the faith development building across the street. I'd like to take a moment to introduce you today to today's speaker, Anna Fleury, who is our social justice coordinator here at Granite Peak. Anna grew up in this congregation and graduated from Wesleyan University in 2017 with a double major in sociology and Latin American studies. Justice work has been part of her life for nearly a decade. She worked as a facilitator, an organizer, educator, and immigrant rights advocate, with an emphasis on Black feminism, environmental and social justice movements, sustainable activism, and youth leadership. We now honor our Unitarian Universalist tradition of lighting our chalice. Our chalice lighter this morning is Art Gorski. May the light we now kindle inspire us to use our powers to heal and not to harm, to help and not to hinder, to bless and not to curse, but to serve in a spirit of love.
Welcome, everyone. I'm so excited to see you all here, everyone in person and also on Zoom. Let's see who's here on Zoom. I see Karen. Hi, Kelsey. I see the Denny's. Joan Brown. There's my mom and dad. Hello. and Norma West, BJ Allgood, Mary Steenhook, so many wonderful faces. Hello, Judy Davis. And I see you all with your cameras off too. Hi, Luther, Uncle Luther, Karen Hagberg, Suki Jones, so many wonderful people. And in the congregation, Patrick, Russ, Lena, Peter, and many other people that I have not named. I just wanted to say welcome. I'm so happy to be here in this space with you all. I'm gonna keep my mask on today, but I have this fancy little thing underneath, so hopefully my projection will still be understandable to folks. And thank you all so much for being here with us this morning. Welcome.
And now I invite those of you here in the sanctuary to join in humming along to our opening hymn. The hymn is How Can Anyone Ever Tell You, sung by the Sacramento Men's Gay Chorus. If you prefer, you may stand in body or spirit. And for those of you at home, there are only four lines to this hymn and they keep repeating themselves. So stand up and sing and enjoy singing your hearts out.
Thank you.
Let's join now together. Let's join now together speaking the words of our covenant. Love is the doctrine of this congregation, the quest for truth its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve others in community. Thus do we covenant together. And now let's hear from Russ Erickson with a message regarding how he feels about supporting this congregation through stewardship.
My name is Russ Erickson, and I've been a member of Granite Peak for 22 years. Currently, I am on the board where I serve as treasurer, and I sing in the Granite Peak Choir. I'm also a member of the Finance and Sanctuary Committees, as well as the Raven Boys. After 34 years of being unchurched, my wife Lena and I, with our two kids, moved from India to Prescott and found Granite Peak. I would never have imagined becoming involved in church work, but soon after becoming a member, I realized I had found a new home. The camaraderie of the people, the work of social justice, and finding a role that I could play to add support have created a bond between myself and Granite Peak. My sense of social justice, including awareness of my white privilege, has been heightened. My joy of singing has also been enhanced, and my worldview has been broadened. I am grateful for all that Granite Peak has brought to my life, and I have come to love and depend upon it as a source of spiritual growth. As treasurer, I see firsthand how much we rely on the generosity of our members to keep Granite Peak financially strong. Please give freely during our upcoming Caring and Sharing Pledge campaign. Your contribution is essential to the well-being of our congregation and to each of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Russ. Each week, we take time to rejoice in the joys and struggle with the sorrows and concerns that have affected us in profound ways. Marianne Clark would like to share a particular joy that she has with us today.
I don't have kids and I don't have grandkids, but I birthed a book.
I will have copies afterwards. It's back. It's called Mother of the Crown. Yes, and I'll be glad to talk to you about all my babies.
If those of you at home didn't hear, the title of the book is Mother of the Crown. Let's collectively support ourselves. Let's collectively support one another in a moment of silence to honor our feelings and our thoughts, and to reflect on those joys and concerns felt by those of us and by those close to us. And may we send a special silent message of support and caring to the people of Ukraine and the stresses currently affecting their lives. So be it, and blessed be. And now let's sing together, Walking With You.
Thank you.
This congregation, its programs, and community outreach are supported by the generosity of its members and friends, as Russ just reminded us. As we take this morning's offering, let us consider what the presence of this congregation in the greater Prescott area means to each of us. Our paid staff and the programs we value are made possible through your contributions, and we thank you for your support. Additionally, our UU values compel us to give back each month to the greater community through our Seeds of Support program. February's recipient is Hungry Kids, and information about them is in your order of service. To give online during this distance time, go to our website, prescottuu.org, and click on Support Granite Peak. Follow the instructions to donate. The offering will now be taken. That was beautiful. We acknowledge the generosity of spirit expressed through this offering. These gifts given in love are received in gratitude. Blessed be. I have a reading this morning that was written by the Reverend Kristen Harper, who is a longtime African-American senior minister at the Unitarian Church of Barnstable, Massachusetts. Reverend Kristen writes, "My inner spirit wrote, I have spent my life watching you, seeing your accomplishments, living the way I think you want me to. I have watched the way you move and the way you talk. I have listened to your story and I've learned your history. I have sat patiently as you explained your politics, your religion, your philosophy of life. I have walked with you on a journey of faith, waiting for my turn to share, to explain, to lead. Look at me. I am black and you are white, but I too am beautiful. Look at my face. Look at my hair. Look at my clothes. They may be different, but aren't they worthy of your gaze? Look at my walk. The way my hips sway to the music in my soul, the way my proud neck tilts to the sun. Yes, look at me. Look at my darkness. It contains light and love, rebirth and growth. Look at my pain. Don't turn away. Look at the way you see me. I am human. I have tears and fears. I have laughter and joy. Look at me and walk with me. I too am beautiful.
What I love about people is when they're just being themselves and not worrying about what they look like.
Eyelashes and my hair extensions, that's it was what we don't have.
It's been something that I've struggled with my entire life, not feeling like I fit in.
See, her perfect, she don't understand, she's worth it, all that beauty goes deeper than the surface, oh, oh. So to all the girls that's hurting, let me be your mirror, help you see a little bit clearer. The light that shines within.
There's a hope that's waiting for you in the dark. You should know you're beautiful just the way you are. And you don't have to change a thing. The world could change its heart. No scars, say you're beautiful. We're stars and we're beautiful.
Hold on and just wait until you can get out of that bubble. Because the things that seem like weaknesses, that seem like weird things that make you strange, when you become an adult, you get out into the world, you're gonna find out that all those differences, they're like your greatest strengths.
A lot of it was in my own head, I realize now.
There's always someone that's unique now, which was the cool part, and that's what made me comfortable, realizing that every single person is different.
My personality outshines everything else at the end of the day.
What only matters is what I think of myself, and that everyone has different kinds of beauty.
Smile. Smile.
You are enough. What comes up when I say that? Is it resistance? Is it relief? Where do you feel it in your body? You are enough. What does your reaction right now tell you about your relationship with that statement? I've had two people tell me on separate occasions recently, you are enough. And what's been coming up for me is a little brittle cry, no, I'm not. But just behind that fragile defense is a tsunami of complicated emotions and a shy but deep desire to believe them, to believe that I am enough. Why is that statement so hard for me to accept? I think it comes first and foremost from a desire to reach the impossible ideal of perfection, which I think many of us are reaching for, even when we don't realize it. That supposed end goal can look different for everyone. For a classical pianist, that goal might look like trying to play the exact notes written on a piece of paper by a long dead old white man. For a PhD candidate, that could mean getting high marks on their dissertation. Or perhaps perfectionism just looks like trying to make the right decision or being a good white person. The common thread between all of these examples is that perfection is externally defined. And I'll tell you a secret, perfect
doesn't exist. It's a scam. So many of us are constantly reaching towards the better and better final outcome, but we'll never reach it because it is by definition unattainable. What that means is that under the tyranny of perfectionism, not one of us will ever be good enough. Perfectionist culture is sneaky. It creeps up on us when we least expect it, and it most often looks like us thinking that we are either better than others or that we don't measure up, or both. I can only speak to my experiences, but I would wager a guess that a lot of you have similar voices in your heads to mine. Oh my God, why did I just say that? I have to finish this task on time or people will think I'm inadequate. Or I've got to make sure at least my top half looks okay before I turn on my video for this Zoom meeting. And we judge others with the same voices that we turn on ourselves first. We judge people for showing up late, for not wearing makeup, for wearing too much makeup, for saying something we disagree with, for making a decision we didn't like. The list goes on and on. It's why we're so terrified of making a mistake in front of other people. If we mess up, not only will we have to deal with our own internal judgy voices, but we imagine all the judgy things that people are thinking and saying about us too. The damaging nature of perfectionism is further revealed by the fact that institutions and people in positions of power often demand higher levels of achievement from people who are more marginalized. For example, women and gender nonconforming people in male-dominated spaces often find ourselves having to work twice as hard to get half the recognition as do Black people, Indigenous people, and people of color in white-dominated spaces. And what is considered a successful achievement in the first place is generally defined by people belonging to the dominant culture, not by those marginalized by dominant culture. Tema Okun, a white upper-class cis woman, with the influence and contributions of other contemporary Black, Indigenous, and people of color who are scholars, wrote an article and created a website called White Supremacy Culture, which lists over a dozen characteristics that she has observed in organizations as blocking radical change and upholding systems of racial injustice. By the way, this list is brilliant, and much of my sermon has been influenced by these ideas, so I will share the website and recommend you check it out. In addition to perfectionism, one characteristic that she writes about is the concept of one right way, which is the belief that there is only one right way to do things, and once people are introduced to the right way, they will see the light and adopt it. Believing that there is only one right or perfect way to do things is how we find ourselves so often chasing unattainable ideals of perfectionism. She says that perfectionism is the belief that we can be perfect or perform perfectly. The question has to be asked, according to who? Who decides what perfect is? We as Unitarians believe in a free and responsible search for truth and meaning, but I think we must be careful not to misinterpret our fourth principle as searching for the singular holy grail of truth and meaning. There is more than one truth in this complicated and paradoxical world of ours, and meaning is ultimately a human construction to try to make sense of everything we don't understand about the world around us. Look around. The natural world teaches us that we need biodiversity in order to thrive. Plants, animals, fungi, bacteria, water, earth, air, and even fire all live out each of their truths in an eternal dance of give and take that exists because they work together in the sacred covenant of balance. To be true to our principles, I believe that we can do the same by loving and honoring the multiplicity of experiences, cultures, and beliefs that we each hold about the world around us. It is through openness and connection with one another that we become stronger together. To believe in a multiplicity of truths means that we must also release binary either-or thinking, like right versus wrong or perfect versus imperfect. Life is not a computer composed of ones and zeros. It is so much more complex. And as far as I know, there is no such thing as an all-knowing human. So how can any of us claim to make a real and true moral judgment? Judgment and morality are by definition subjective and relative to one's experiences and perspective. Think about some of the things that each of us believe to be right and wrong. Other words that sometimes stand in for right and wrong can be polite versus impolite, or correct versus incorrect, perfect versus imperfect, enough versus not enough. There are so many moments in this society where we are asked to pick either or, Democrat or Republican, male or female, paper or plastic. We even create either or moral judgments for our fellow humans. You're either in or out, good or evil, saved or heathen, smart or dumb, pretty or ugly, respectable or crass or slutty or thuggish, a racist or not a racist. The list goes on in a million and one ways that this society has taught us to judge ourselves and each other by convincing us that there is a perfect and an imperfect way to do something. How many of you have ever heard someone say, for example, "I believe in what they're fighting for. I just think they need to do it the right way." Who decides what the right way is? And who is excluded from that decision-making process? Who benefits by rewarding people doing the right thing and punishes people doing the wrong thing? How is the concept of perfect serving as a fuel for oppressive forces? Often the societal beliefs that fuel our perfectionism are not in service to love, life, and connection. Rather, they maintain destructive systems that benefit some people materially while actively harming others, but which ultimately are antithetical to liberation work and are damaging on some level to all of us. Personally, I struggle daily with my perfectionism and my fear of coming up short, of not being enough. But admitting that I am not perfect can leave space for me to say, "I don't know," and to listen to the wisdom of others. It's difficult for me to admit this, but one of the places where I feel most imperfect and inadequate is when I am working closely with Black people, Indigenous people, and people of color around racial justice work, also known as BIPOC. When writing this sermon, I felt my heart beat faster and the blood rushed to my head as I deliberated whether I could actually say this truth of mine in front of you, particularly as your social justice coordinator. Practically my entire life and career is centered around social justice. And for the past few years, that work has been almost exclusively focused around immigration and racial justice. So to admit that I feel less than perfect in spaces where I'm closely working with BIPOC folks whom I respect and look up to, people whose respect I hope to earn as well, is to admit that I don't always know what the right thing to do is. And in fact, sometimes I do the wrong thing. I'm afraid of the harm that those mistakes may cause. And if I'm being really honest with myself, I'm also afraid of being judged as not good enough or racist. That version of trying to be perfect and right and good is actually me operating from the perspective that I am somehow better than the imaginary bad white person who is imperfect and wrong and bad, which creates distance between me and the racist white person and allows me to shirk responsibility for my actions because at least I'm not like those people. Thanks to the many BIPOC folks in my life, by the way, who helped me to learn this about myself. In those moments of perfectionism, I am actually doing more towards serving my own ego than towards serving the movement and building connection with the people around me. And yet I continue to struggle with my fear of being imperfect. But I think that this twisting paradox that I am imperfect and yet continue to do this work is critical to understanding my place in the movement. It leaves space for me to ask myself, where are my motivations coming from? When I enter a multiracial space, am I letting my self-centered anxieties define how I move through the space, worried about how I will be perceived, if I'm signaling wokeness enough, or even if people will notice how hard I'm trying? Or am I instead decentering myself and focusing on how the work that we are doing together is bringing us closer to freedom and a world in balance, and how incredible the people I'm working with are, and how much I have for this earth and the people in it. I've learned in this work that sometimes trying to be a good white person is not what is needed. Rather, what is needed is for me to admit that I don't always know how to best show up, and that I have to trust the lived experiences of Black, Indigenous, and people of color to guide me instead of privileging my own perspective. It also means accepting that this is community work, not individual work, which means partnering with other white anti-racists to learn and grow, rather than villainizing and trying to one-up other white people so that the burden of education doesn't fall solely on the shoulders of people of color. Because ultimately, I believe that a better world is possible. I have to believe that. And that starts with me showing up from a place of love rather than judgment. Even though we live in a world more complex than our tiny human brains have any way of ever fully comprehending, I believe that we are all born with something within us that is integral to our being and the key to being in balanced relationship with the world. That key is love. By the way, happy Galentine's Day, day before Valentine's Day. A few months ago, I had an epiphany. In this work and in my life, I often find myself asking, what is the right thing to do here? How can I avoid making the wrong decision? I would find myself doing exhausting and impossible mental gymnastics to try to land on the right decision, when perhaps there wasn't really a totally right answer at all. And one day I realized, I'm asking the wrong questions. So as an experiment, whenever I noticed myself trying to decide whether something was right or wrong, or good or bad, I started asking myself instead, what would move this situation towards a more balanced place? And it completely shifted how I thought about decision making. For example, deciding whether to schedule an event on my day off, which I don't know if those of you were at Patty's service on Sabbath, so great, love rest. So when deciding whether to schedule an event on my day off, it became less of a question of whether I should or should not sacrifice my rest for other people. And instead it became clear to me that choosing to rest on that day would allow me to show up for myself and for future events from a place of abundance rather than emptiness. Choosing to follow through with the inconvenience of maintaining a compost bucket became less of a begrudging acquiescence to doing the right thing and more of a joy in practicing living in closer balance with the natural world. It moved the location of decision-making from this external imagined absolute of good versus bad into this internal place of more intuitive knowledge. Moving towards balance can be personally spiritually healing, but I also believe it's what we need in our movements, because ultimately this is a world built upon monumental and centuries of imbalance, where a tiny percentage of people have stolen most of the world's resources, created a system to maintain and widen that imbalance, and the rest of the people and Earth don't matter. We have perched our privileged lives atop a long history of ongoing oppression and environmental destruction. But now we find that our supposedly impenetrable steel hull has been rent by a melting iceberg, and we are losing our balance as our deck tips towards deathly waters. So we have a choice now. Do we accept our faith, letting most die while only the most privileged get lifeboats? Or do we find a way to follow the lead of those who have been struggling to right the boat for generations and move towards balance? What I'm inviting us to do here is something that's scary. I'm inviting us to let go of our deep-seated beliefs that there is a right way and a wrong way to do things. In other words, I'm inviting us to let go of judgment and replace it with something else. I'm inviting us to accept that we are imperfect, that sometimes we don't know, that we are still and will forever continue learning, that we get to sit with our privilege, and that the same is true of the people around us asking those questions. I'm asking us to believe that we are and will always be both imperfect and enough. Accepting our inherent enoughness means sewing ourselves back up from this war inside of our heads of good versus bad, perfect versus imperfect. It means believing that the people around us are also enough, which leaves room for us to find our own truths and to respect and learn from the truths of others. It means releasing the pressure to want more, more, more as we try to fulfill this unattainable quest for perfection. And believing that we are enough is far different from believing that we are perfect. Perfect is static. Enoughness is dynamic, and it begs the question, enough to do what? Believing that we are enough means believing that we can be whole and work towards a wider wholeness together. And in this broken world, creating wholeness is no small feat. I believe that love is a connection to the wholeness and the multiplicity of life. It's a part of us. We are love, and therefore we are enough. We have the answer. Whenever we find ourselves in these either-or scenarios or moments where we are judging ourselves and others, we have the opportunity to ask ourselves whether there's a third option. We get to ask ourselves, what would it look like right now to move from a place of love? After all, the world we are building is not perfect. Perfection only exists within a human-created binary, and as we have established, humans are not perfect. The world we are building is messy, and there is conflict, and people make mistakes. We're not trying to build a perfect world. What we're building is a loving world. We're building a freer world, a joyful world. And each of us has the sacred power within us to share love, to enable freedom in others, to celebrate joy. Every day, we can choose to push perfectionism and judgment aside and choose love and connection instead. Because at our core, we are made of love. We are meant to be free. And joy is what we feel when we remember these truths. And when we know this truth, we know that we are enough. So now we're all gonna say it together. I am enough. I am enough. We are enough. We are enough. Thank you so much. And have a beautiful rest of your day. Oh, I want to put something in the chat. I also wanted to take a moment to thank my many teachers and mentors who have radically changed how I view and move through the world, and especially the Black femmes that I've learned from, including Vanessa Rochelle Lewis, Amira Aero, Sonia Renee Taylor, and Adrienne Marie Brown. I can share some of their links for you if you want to consider supporting. Black femmes almost never get fairly compensated for their radical wisdom, magic, and activism. And I'm also sending gratitude to the many other queer and feminist ancestors who have struggled so that I and people like me can live more freely. Thank you. All right. All yours.
Thank you, Anna. I think your message is something that resonates with so many of us. And perhaps something we should take into this season of Valentine's Day is the importance of self-love. We will close this morning with a closing hymn that Lena will be playing for us. For those of you here in the sanctuary, if you want to stand in body or spirit, sing or dance along and hum with masks on if you like. It's not a hymn, but you're still welcome to dance and sing anyway. No words. Sorry. Okay. Hey, look me over. Thank you.
To close us out, I wanted to share a quote by Audre Lorde. "You do not have to be me in order for us to fight alongside each other. I do not have to be you to recognize that our wars are the same. What we must do is commit ourselves to some future that can include each other and to move towards that future with the particular strengths of our individual identities. And in order for us to do this, we must allow each other our differences at the same time that we recognize our sameness." Audre Lorde, thank you.
With the extinguishing of our chalice, our worship time has ended, and now our service begins. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. So before we break up, I just thought I would let you folks know at home on Zoom that we have probably between 25 and 30 people here this morning. And I wonder if there are any people here in the sanctuary who are new, who might like to stand and introduce themselves. I think some people have come today especially to hear Anna. Anyone that would like to say good morning? Okay, well, we're glad you're here. Please feel free now to join for conversation here in the sanctuary, or if you'd like to, it's a beautiful day outdoors. Go out and talk with one another. And for those of you on Zoom who would like to join a breakout room, hang tight, and Heather will put the information up on the screen about how to do that. Thanks for being with us this morning.